Welcome back. You're watching a special broadcast on the 16th G20 summit. Professor Cholia, you know, the other important issue in the G20 is building safe and resilient supply chains. We've seen particular focus on this issue in the Quad summit, also in the bilateral meetings that the PM had yesterday with the EU Council President, as well as EU Commission President, as well as the Italian Prime Minister Mario Draghi. There was a mention on ensuring safe and resilient global supply chains and diversification of supply chains, particularly in the context of the Indo-Pacific. So how important could this an issue be in the G20 this time around? Do you expect it to find mention in the outcome document?
Yeah, I think the whole world is focused on supply chain because of the energy shortages and the sudden, you know, blackouts that many countries have been facing, also production lines are all struggling. Many places, manufacturers are saying that components are just not coming, raw materials are not coming. They're all, stuck, in ports or in the high seas. So there is an issue with a lot of snags in the free movement of all the components that make up manufactured products right now. And the Christmas and the New Year season is coming. The rich countries that consume a lot of these durable goods are all looking at possibly empty shelves and nothing to sell or buy. So there is this issue, and this is not just because of specific factors. There's a broader problem, which is that the bounce back from the pandemic depression like condition of last year has been such that suddenly there's a surge in demand. Some countries, there is a so-called revenge shopping and stuff like that you hear, and as a result of it, there's just not enough to immediately meet the needs. So, and there's going to be no quick recovery from the pandemic if these supply chain issues are not sorted. So one is simply greater coordination at the G20 to remove these bottlenecks. The other, the resilience part, Munmun, is of course linked to the China factor. I mean, Xi Jinping is not attending this G20 in person. And there has been a lot of concern about over-dependence on China and how to shift and to create other locus and other centers on which the world can depend for a variety of goods and services. So I think this is going to be a long-term project. The Chinese still have skin in the game because they have, attracted capital from the West for more than 30 years, almost 30 years. And so now there's a China plus one strategy. A lot of multinationals are looking at alternatives, but without completely quitting China. So it's going to be a gradual process and the resilience. And I think G20 at the level of leaders, they also need to do something to about macroeconomic stimulus, especially for poorer countries. Ambassador Mohan Kumar mentioned the poverty and inequality. These are at an all-time high as a result of the pandemic's economic blows and in many parts of the world. And for that to happen, a lot of the low-income countries need sustainable debt relief. G20 has spearheaded this initiative, and India has been one of the big champions of this to postpone debt repayments and all these things further down the line, or even cancel them. I mean, there's a whole social movement worldwide for justice, historical justice, where rich countries and big private owners of capital should actually waive off debts that they want to recover from poor countries when you have social unrest growing. The US intelligence estimates, Munmun, most recent ones say that, there's going to be massive social unrest in many countries, leading to even overthrows of regimes, and we are already seeing military coups in Africa and all that. So it's very important that G20 comes, puts their head together and work on these kind of issues. Low income countries really need a helping hand. That's why we are saying Prime Minister Modi is going to be a major advocate and a champion for developing countries. Right now they're looking up because the low-income countries, not even one of them is present in G20. They're absent. They're not even at the table, but their concerns have to be addressed by G20, because if not G20, as Ambassador Mohan Kumar is saying, nobody else can answer this. So keeping them, it's the Mahatma Gandhi principle, the poorest person on this planet has to be addressed. Otherwise, G20 has no relevance in a global sense. We can always talk about the most powerful or the happening countries or the emerging powers. That's not enough. So I think India's mission always remains on trade issues, on health issues, on economic issues.
Yes.
The point is, we will champion outcomes and policies and specific agreements that benefit the last person in the line.
Let me take this thought further, Professor Cholia. Do you agree with the points put forth by Ambassador Kumar, the fact that Chinese President and Russian President are not present in person at the G20 summit, and the issue of debt restructuring is something that we don't expect to be addressed in the absence of the Chinese President? And I remember when Foreign Secretary Harshvardhan Shringla, before leaving for the G20 summit, had also said that one of the focus areas would be on sustainable finance for infrastructure.
Yeah, well, you know, I think they're hiding because they don't want to make commitments for the collective good. The problem with China, of course, like Ambassador Mohan Kumar is saying, one is they want a stranglehold on poor countries using debt as a weapon. They have done it with many, we have seen in the Indo-Pacific and even in Africa. So they would not want to let go of that leverage and be overly generous by suspending all the payments or simply writing them off. So I don't think they want to make any such commitment. And with Russia, you know, it's about energy again. Russia uses energy as an important weapon against its adversaries in the West. It has an ongoing tussle with the European Union. Suddenly, the winter has come, they're going to freeze, and, you know, they are dependent on Russia, and Russia wants to, extract its pound of flesh in return for its gas supplies, which is to isolate Ukraine and other countries, which are challenging Russia's what Russia sees as its territorial integrity. So I think there is a politicization of these issues, and I think these leaders, they may have other domestic political pressing issues as well at home. But whatever it is, I think it is a G20 without two heavyweights, and a few more are not coming. So there are some domestic preoccupations, I guess, with some of the leaders. On the wider issue of the North versus South thing, this comes out very clearly on the climate negotiations that are coming up. And G20, it is a challenge. I mean, like we have been saying, it is a unique amalgam of developing and developed countries.
Yes.
But then there is this fault line between North and South that you see clearly on so many issues. We champion the cause of the South always, and where we are pragmatic also, we do give and take with the North. But this contradiction cannot be resolved by G20 in that sense, So I think they are like, I think as Ambassador Mohan Kumar, who's an expert, who's like a veteran at negotiations, knows there's going to be some anodyne language on these issues, and they're going to kick the can down the road on concrete issues. The one issue on which they are all in agreement and which is a low-hanging fruit is this minimum corporate tax,
yes,
15% on multinational corporations. We are also in favor of it. We need more revenues. All the countries of the world need revenues. They are starved of revenues to spend on their people, to save their societies right now as they emerge out of this long economic crisis. So it's a good measure. The OECD took the initiative first. Now 140 countries nearly have endorsed it. And we have also joined hands with this initiative, and we want tech companies to also pay more. Our position, our Sherpa Minister Piyush Goyal mentioned that we want the countries, the multinational corporations, to pay more in the countries where they are sourcing their profits,
yes,
not where they're headquartered or where, you know, they have created all these offshore havens to avoid taxation. So on that fact, I think it's a good stimulus. It's an informal stimulus for the global economy. Hundreds of billions of dollars will now accrue and come to the treasuries of countries, and governments really need that fiscal booster right now. So I think G20 is going to endorse and make sure that this is happening quicker. What is, you see, most of these agreements, when you say 15% minimum tax, they're saying there's going to be a window and then it'll take 10 years or something before the actual taxes kick in, you know, and people pay, the big global companies pay it. Some of these big US companies, their annual turnover is more than GDP of a lot of poor countries, you know. And this is a time for justice and equity when people are suffering a lot from the COVID-induced economic, long economic crisis. This is the time for G20 to press the button and say, you know, no more of this, and we will crack down. And the multinational enterprises have to comply and do it faster. And almost every country is on agreement on this, you know, no matter what our individual differences, because we all need better public finances to be able to emerge out of this economic crisis.
On the issue of digital economy, Professor Cholia, India has been calling for a balance between free flow of data and trust. It says that the development imperatives of developing countries need to be accommodated. Now, this has been a contentious issue in the past several years. India has a different take, and several developed countries have a different take. Do you think that this issue could also be taken up in the G20 summit and find mention in the outcome document?
Yeah, you know, the whole issue of digital economy is now foremost because it's overshadowing all the earlier forms of economic exchanges. I mean, there's so much happening between countries in terms of information flows, and countries have a legitimate right also to restrict and to control some of this and to generate revenues out of this. So there is this big question mark about some countries like China and Russia have taken the position that, you know, they, this internet sovereignty, you know, they want the state to be able to access and to control and to retrieve anything they want from foreign players operating in their domestic markets. And then there are others who have got this middle position. I think if I'm not wrong, the International Telecommunications Union is also involved. There are a number of other organizations dealing with this. But at the larger, the global level, you know, one of the things we have done in India in a big way is, you know, to digitalize all our welfare schemes and projects. We have the India Stack, which is one of the most successful example of digital inclusion, and it's now open source software that can be used by any other country, and we believe it can be a game changer for Africa and others, you know, to integrate all their financial payments and gateways into under a single software. These are some of these innovations we are doing, and I think we should be promoting this. And the PM has been talking, see, National Hydrogen Mission, India Stack. These are some of our very, very unique, you know, strengths when we go to these global forums, where we can offer our technology and our means to be able to solve global issues using digital means. But in a way that, you know, which still gives sovereign states some control and power, because you can't have complete free for all by, you know, global tech giants. That much, I think, India also agrees. But to what they also benefit our local economy. There's a, you know, we all of our, many of our services are linked to US based companies, and we definitely trust them more than we trust the Chinese, for example. And there is no national security red flag as far as the Western companies go, which are providing digital services in our country. So we've got to balance out all the, I think we are somewhere in the middle. Ambassador Mohan Kumar knows more.
It's not often that we look at proper focus on an issue that concerns half of the global population, that is women, their leadership in the private sector. Do you think that this is a genuine attempt being made at ensuring that there is gender parity in every sense of the term?
Well, Moon, the thing is, you know, the pandemic has adversely and disproportionately hit women. The data shows that, you know, more women have lost jobs. More women have been forced to enter disreputable practices simply to make a living. More women have been rendered homeless. There has been, you know, a complete devastation in the worst COVID-affected countries, which is weighed against women. So the question is, this is linked even to the global recovery, like you said, half of the earth. So G20, if they prioritize an action plan that will, for example, they're working from home, those arrangements have become very critical. You know, social structures and families will collapse if there is no flexibility on this matter. So it's very important if there's a global norm. This is the beauty of G20 or these multilateral institutions, right? If they set a general standard saying, you know, we must be more, we must create work practices and workplaces that are friendlier and more equitable for women, then it will boost our recovery, and therefore these are the norms and the standards, and then individual member countries can then, you know, enact legislation or pass administrative orders domestically in their respective countries to implement this. So G20 is always, you know, it works through persuasion and through consensus and creating norms. It's not a legal thing. Just because you know the G20 says that they take us to court that we have not implemented. It's more like changing the values. So I think it's very important. Angela Merkel is on her way out, and this I think is definitely going to be our last G20. The very few women, even among the world leaders, unfortunately, right now, once she departs. So I think it's very important that we highlight this and to take this forward. Women's representation in offices in power, and also these specific intelligent interventions within the economic spaces to make them more productive, and so that the what we call the feminization of poverty, this has become rampant because of the pandemic. This has to be reversed, otherwise there's no overall recovery. There's no way they can do a fast track recovery if women remain out of work and are remain outside the labor force and are forced to juggle everything on their own with no compensation. So I think the G20 has got the values right. It's a question of finding the right language and building this, these norms on the basis of which, they will disseminate and percolate. One good thing about G20 is they've dealt with crises. It was the 2008 onwards, it was a crisis fighting organization. Now again, we are in a crisis. In the middle years, after 2016, 2017, people started saying G20 has lost its identity. What is it going to do? They are just throwing the kitchen sink. All kinds of issues are being added on and there is no crisis. What's the need of a G20? Now we've got a crisis. The pandemic and the economic depression it has caused is tremendous. Globally, the poverty has increased by hundreds of millions. And the SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals, have been set back. So if G20 does not rise to the occasion now, people will say, what is the utility of it? So I think it has to do this and bring women into focus. Labor, women, trade unions, all these are very important. And they have working groups and all these things. They have additional discussion forums to carry forward these things. It's a very elaborate process. But ultimately, the woman on the street in Madagascar or in Mozambique or in Malawi has to see it, and that's the proof of the pudding.
Professor Cholia, there is also an event which is called G20 Innovation League being hosted by the Italian presidency, and the focus is on sharing of views and innovative solutions to key global challenges and fostering global cooperation. Now, we've seen in the Quad particularly, and in the visit that the Prime Minister had to the US, where he met various industry captains, on how there was focus on investment in innovation and critical and emerging technologies. Here we are looking at focusing on innovative solutions to key global challenges and fostering global cooperation. What do you make of this G20 Innovation League, and what is it that one can achieve through such innovative solutions to key global challenges?
Well, Munmun, I was just mentioning the India Stack, for example. These are, very genuine indigenous innovations that our software sector has done. And this can really, all the social welfare schemes, direct benefit transfer, cash handouts, subsidies, all these can be actually easily pooled under these India Stack. And this kind of thing, is an innovation. Covin, our Covin app, is an extraordinary innovation. And, more than 140 countries have shown an interest in adopting it as they go forward in fighting the pandemic and other health crises in their country, in their respective countries. So we have such, extraordinary feats done by our technicians and our engineers. And this is what I think Prime Minister Modi always believes in projecting, because he believes India can provide solutions to the world's problems. So yes, innovation is something here with the startup, climate within India getting, revving up in a big way, and young entrepreneurs. I think PM always believes that this is the future. And he has emphasized this often in his interactions with world leaders and in these kinds of forums. So we will definitely want to promote it. But like with climate adaptation and like with vaccine manufacturing, there is a dearth of venture capital financing, and this does not generate enough ideas and opportunities for young people to come up with, to fructify their ideas, So I think that's very important that G20 creates a fund to promote innovation. There are lots of these funds going around. Some of them are in totally private hands. And my view is, if governments come in and all of them agree that this is a priority area in education, in finance, in healthcare, this should be innovation, not so much to based on intellectual property rights and maximizing profits and creating big national champions or powerful corporate success stories. I don't mean innovation, because generally in the private sector they talk about innovation differently. Here we need social innovation, social entrepreneurship. If there are if there is a water supply idea in Africa or in Latin America or in South Asia that can then be exported or copied by other countries successfully, which will solve issues of hygiene, that's the type of innovative model. If we can scale it up through G20 support, nothing like it. And it goes back to my earlier point that low income countries are looking up to G20 and asking, what are you going to do for us? The ones at the bottom of the rung. So innovation, which is social and which is based on equity, is something very close to Prime Minister Modi's heart. And I think India is going to play a major role in advancing this G20 innovation initiative.